next speaker will be Graham Hancock, and the topic of this next presentation is extremely profound, very, very important, and extremely cutting edge. And this is what Graham does, and it takes courage to bring this kind of information, this kind of knowledge. And again, as I've said before, Graham is one of the most admired presenters in the era of the new earth, the new discoveries, understanding our true heritage and understanding who we truly are and how we can explore our own consciousness. It takes courage because it would seem as if there are organizations that don't want us to expand, that there are organized forces that want to block our movement forward. And so this next topic is extremely important, extremely profound, and absolutely one of the highlights of this gathering. So he is one of the most articulate speakers that I have ever met, and a pleasure to listen to, and the intelligence and penetrating information that he's going to provide is absolutely astonishing. So a round of applause for Graham Hancock.
If I could begin with a little appeal for help. In a series of visions in Brazil in 2007, it was communicated to me that I needed to branch out into writing fiction, that I needed to express my extraordinary ideas, the extraordinary ideas that I've been lucky enough to investigate in the form of adventure stories, in the form of fiction. And my publishers don't agree with this. They hear the cash tills ringing for the non-fiction, not for the fiction, and I'm trying to persuade them that they are wrong. What's up on the screen is a novel that's going to be published in June next year. So far, only in Britain. Nobody in America has yet taken this novel on. But if we can make it work in Britain, then it certainly will be taken on in America. I know it's a lot to ask you, but if anybody here can do this, you would strengthen my hand enormously by going to amazon.co.uk and advance ordering this book. It will be sent anywhere in the world, and it would help to show my publishers that there is interest in Graham Hancock the novelist. It's quite difficult to reinvent oneself completely at the age of 60, but actually 62 now, that's what I feel called to do. And as I say, I'll be next door from the end of this presentation through until about 5:30 or 6, if anybody does want any books signed. And that's my website up there on the screen, and also my YouTube channel. By the way, the novel that is going to be published in June is about the Spanish conquest of Mexico, and it's about the story of Cortez and Montezuma and an extraordinary woman called Malinal, who became the interpreter of Cortez. Cortez was able to succeed in Mexico against the standing army of 200,000 that the Aztecs were able to put into the field because he cynically exploited an ancient legend and managed to persuade Montezuma that he was the god of peace, the god Quetzalcoatl, returning from across the sea. And it's just one of those amazing, extraordinary synchronicities of history that the year that Cortez landed in Mexico, 1519, was the year one read in the Aztec calendar, which was the year in which Quetzalcoatl, depicted as white-skinned and bearded, crossing the sea in a boat that moved by itself without paddles, was expected to return. And Cortez took advantage of this prophecy and used it to psychologically dominate Moctezuma so that with 400 men he was able to overcome an army of 200,000. I first came across the story of Quetzalcoatl when I was researching Fingerprints of the Gods, and inadvertently traveled the route of Cortez in the journeys that my wife Santa and I made around Mexico, way back in the early 90s when we were working first of all on Fingerprints of the Gods. And my wife Santa is here with me today, and she's sitting somewhere over there. Can't see her because of the light. And I want to thank Santa for being my partner and my spiritual guide in all the adventures that we have had, whether it's been climbing to the top of the Great Pyramid or diving 140 feet beneath the sea. Santa's a photographer, and she took almost all the photographs that I'll show today. There are a few exceptions, and where there are exceptions, I've acknowledged the photographer in a subtitle. So there we were in Mexico, and the conventional theory has it that that the Americas were peopled entirely by Asiatic people from across the Bering Strait during the Ice Age, when the ice connected what is now Alaska and Russia. And that this whole settlement of the Americas by these Asiatics took place not much more than 12 or 13,000 years ago. So it was very odd to find ourselves in La Venta, in the Gulf of Mexico, and to find statues and imagery of individuals who clearly were not Asiatic in any sense, but who were rather white-skinned and bearded Caucasian-looking people. And it's that imagery that's associated with the tradition of Quetzalcoatl, and one of them is here. I hope you can see him on the left-hand side of the screen. This is clearly not an American Indian. This is somebody with a beard, with features that look distinctly Caucasian. And the imagery of the feathered serpent, which the Aztecs absorbed, also goes back to this period. Now, this period, La Venta, is dated to 1500 BC, 3,500 years ago. But I believe it's actually much older than that. And part of the theme of the talk I want to give you today is that archaeology has made some serious mistakes in the dating of particular monuments and sites, and has all too often handed over to the latest inhabitants of those sites work that was done by much earlier peoples. Also in Mexico, you find people with rather Semitic features like this. Again, clearly not a Native American Indian. And this is from Monte Albán, and also orthodoxly dated to about 3,000 years ago. And what about this chap? You know, I mean, again, look at that heavy beard. These heavy beards are not characteristic of Native Americans, and these Caucasian features. So it became a mystery to me. How do we explain this? How do we explain the legends and traditions of these visitors who were said to have come in a time of darkness and brought civilization after a great cataclysm? There are just so many such images all over Mexico. And those images also occur in South America. We came across them again in the high Andes of Bolivia, around the mysterious site of Tiwanaku, 4,000 meters up in the Andes, in the Andes Mountains, about 14,000 feet. You come across this just this amazing site, which archaeology has attributed to the period of about 1000 BC. But this attribution is based on the excavation of less than 1% of the site. And all too often, where you're dealing with dating, what you're dating is organic materials. You can't actually date stone, but you can date organic materials, and there's a danger of contamination by later cultures, and actually what you're looking at is a site that's much older, but you're dating more recent organic material that has entered the site. So again, in Tiwanaku, we find these bearded, non-Native American-looking peoples, and they're also associated with a myth, and that's the myth of Viracocha, or the Viracochas, who again came from across the sea in a time of darkness, bringing the gifts of civilization after some kind of fall that had affected humanity. Go over to Easter Island. I think everybody's familiar with the amazing stone heads of the Moai of Easter Island. And what's noticeable about them is these very prominent chins, you know. But actually, if you get up closer and take a look at it, you can see that these chins are beards, and that these are also bearded individuals. And one of the themes I want to explore concerning Easter Island is that it may have been radically misdated by archaeologists. Well, here's our gem, our jewel of a planet that the universe has gifted us with. What a privilege it is to be born in a human body and to live in this magical, enchanted realm, floating on the ocean of the cosmos, and to have the opportunity to learn and to grow and to develop here through many lifetimes, because we've all been here before, and we're all struggling to remember. There was a time, not so long ago, when our planet didn't look quite the way it looks today. And that was called the Last Ice Age. It set on about 125,000 years ago, and it reached its maximum extent, what's called the last glacial maximum, about 21,000 years ago, very recently in geological terms. And when the last glacial maximum was reached, gigantic ice caps sat on top of North America and of Northern Europe. And when I say gigantic, I mean huge. These ice caps were 2 miles deep. Can you imagine that? 2 miles of ice covering the whole North American continent, 2 miles deep. High as mountains, everywhere. What a different world it was. Where did that all that ice come from? Where it came from was the oceans. Came from evaporated water that was lifted up into the atmosphere, fell as rain, and froze into ice in the cold, cold earth of that time. And as a result, sea level was much, much lower then than it is today, because all that water had been taken out of the ocean and frozen up onto those ice caps covering North America and, as I say, Northern Europe. So we must envisage a very different world. Areas that are densely inhabited and economically productive today were completely out of circulation. They were just total ice mountains, very cold, very arid. Nobody could live there. And areas that are underwater today, because when all the ice melted, sea level rose by 400 feet, areas that are underwater today were above water then. And how can we get to grips with our past if we don't take account of these radical changes that have taken place across the surface of the Earth in the last 20,000 years? So here's the familiar map of planet Earth today. And we all know it. We all understand it. It's recognizable at the last glacial maximum, but if you look closer, there are distinct differences. There was, for example, no Red Sea. There was no Persian Gulf. Sri Lanka was joined on to India. There was an enormously extended Southeast Asia, a continent-sized landmass that was called Sundaland. The geologists know it as Sundaland. And Australia was joined on to New Guinea, was vastly larger. Everywhere the coastlines were greatly extended. Actually 10 million square miles of land that is underwater today was above water then. And 10 million square miles is about the size of Europe and China added together. All that ice melted down over a period of 10 or 11,000 years. And that sounds quite gradual, it sounds quite gentle. One could imagine getting to grips with a slow meltdown of the ice age over 10 or 12,000 years. But that's not how it happened. It happened in a series of gigantic episodes of melting, punctuated by long periods of stability. And the reason was that the ice accumulated in gigantic glacial lakes, the meltwater accumulated in gigantic glacial lakes on top of the ice caps. And sometimes that meltwater would be present, growing and growing and growing for 4,000 years. before the lake would burst its boundaries. One of the mysteries is that these glacial lakes burst their boundaries simultaneously in Europe and North America. Some factor seems to have been at work, and you would just get this sudden flush of enormous quantities of water tearing down across the land, scouring the landscape in the way. I mean, in North America, the scablands of New Jersey, the Finger Lakes of New York State, are remnants of these outburst floods, scouring the land and pouring into the world ocean and raising the level of the ocean very, very suddenly, very dramatically, by as much as 30 or 40 feet in some cases, almost literally overnight. Now, you have to ask yourself, could we handle that today? If sea level rose by 40 feet overnight, every coastal city was instantly flooded. You know, we find it difficult enough to deal with Hurricane Katrina or the Boxing Day tsunami, but this is a global disaster on an unimaginable scale. And it happened several times during the last ice age. And when it happened, it was accompanied by enormous episodes of volcanic activity and earthquake activity as well. Now, archaeology doesn't accept that any memory could have been preserved of these floods. That's why archaeology, when confronted by the phenomenon of more than 2,000 flood myths from around the world, prefers to believe that those are results of primitive peoples exaggerating little local floods in relatively recent history. And I find that completely unnecessary, because the fact is we had global floods between 21,000 and 11,000 years ago, and those global floods were on a horrendous scale. And that, I believe, is what is remembered in the flood myths from all around the world. And some of those flood myths are very familiar to us. One of the best known, I'm sure known to everyone in this room, is the story of Atlantis, of the lost civilization of Atlantis. Because in many, many cases, these flood myths, as they're called, don't simply say that there was a flood, but they say there was a civilization before the flood. And it was a high civilization, an advanced civilization, and it was destroyed by the flood. And they have a common theme. They say that this civilization was once spiritually wise, that it lived in harmony with the universe, but that it went through a kind of corruption or decline, and that it became arrogant and cruel and mean-spirited and vicious and lost its respect for the universe. And as a result, the gods punished this civilization with the flood. And this is indeed the story that Plato passes down to us in the story of Atlantis. I'm sure many of you are aware that the earliest surviving reference to Atlantis comes in the work of Plato. And Plato says that he received the story from his ancestor Solon, the famous Greek lawmaker, who lived around 600 BC. And Solon, in turn, had been given the story by the ancient Egyptians when he made a journey to Egypt and visited the temple of Sais in the Delta, and was told there of the civilization of Atlantis and how the founders of the civilization of ancient Egypt had come from Atlantis. And Plato said that the events that destroyed Atlantis in a single terrible day and night took place 9,000 years before the time of Solon. That's 9,600 BC. That's 11,600 years ago. And it just happens that 11,600 years ago is one of those times of gigantic melting at the end of the last ice age. Many archaeologists, most, actually almost all, want to dismiss Plato's story as a fantasy. They want to say that he just made the whole thing up. Some of them even want to say that when he said 9,000 years, he meant 9,000 months. You know, the lengths that they will go to just not to listen to the plain facts of the story. But if he made it up, it's really quite extraordinary, because he could have known nothing of the Ice Age, that he actually chose one of those times of gigantic melting and earthquake activity. And he said that it was such a severe cataclysm that after it, mankind had to begin again like children, with no memory of what went before. A species, if you like, with amnesia is what we became. And this story of the great flood of the lost civilization before it is repeated all around the world. And very often there's a Noah figure, a figure who seeks to preserve the essence of civilization and transmit it to future generations. It's in India, it's Manu. In Greece, it's Deucalion and Pyrrha. The same story is found amongst the ancient Maya. The Dresden Codex may refer to the flood at the end of the Ice Age, and the language of the Dresden Codex is truly alarming, portraying this final, all-embracing cataclysm. Of course, we're most familiar with the story of Noah, and anyone reared in the Judeo-Christian tradition is well aware of the story of Noah and of Noah's Ark. But it's completely clear that the story of Noah was simply a later recension of an already existing and much more ancient story, because all of the fine details of the story of Noah in the Bible are found in what is called the Gilgamesh epic, the Epic of Gilgamesh, from Sumer. And Sumer occupies the land area that we now call Iraq in the Arabian Peninsula. That is, in fact, the combined streams of the Tigris and Euphrates rivers, which formed a giant watercourse in the basin of which lay several fertile lakes. If anywhere on Earth is a candidate for the Garden of Eden, it's this place. And it was flooded cataclysmically between 12 and 13,000 years ago and filled up and made to look much as it does today. So I'm not surprised that we find the progenitor of the Noah myth in that region. And we find these myths in Australia as well, preserved amongst the Aboriginal people who we know have been in Australia for at least 50 or 60,000 years. They too tell stories of gigantic floods that that ate up the land. So contrary to the archaeologists, I'm not puzzled at all that we have memorialized these events in global myths and traditions. It makes perfect sense to me. Anything else would be odd. But what's more surprising is to find rather specific and clear references to this window of time between 12 and 13,000 years ago in a place like the Giza Plateau, where stand the three great pyramids of Egypt. I've been privileged to spend a great deal of the last 25 years in Egypt and to get to know these monuments well. They've become a kind of second home to me. It's such a beautiful place, Giza. Again, I'm sure that many in this room have been to Giza and have been touched by its enchantment. There's the great pyramid of Giza, I'm showing you first of all the plateau. But there is the great pyramid of Giza with the last surviving wonder of the ancient world. And we're looking now up the southwest corner of the Great Pyramid of Giza. And should you wish to climb the Great Pyramid, which is illegal, that's the corner you want to go up. Santa and I have climbed the Great Pyramid five times, luckily. And we've learnt from experience that the southwest corner is the way to go, because it does provide you a pretty clear guideline. It takes about half an hour to scramble up there. It's got a 13-acre footprint, you know, and it weighs 6 million tons, and it consists of 2.3 million blocks of stone. I mean, just everything about the Great Pyramid is massive, monumental, stunning, and extraordinary. And the three great pyramids do tower over the modern city of Cairo today. You can't fail to be reminded of them wherever you go in Cairo. Now, Santa took this photograph from an Egyptian military helicopter hovering over the Great Pyramids. And we're actually on the northeast side of the plateau here. And this is the village of Nazlet al-Saman that clusters around the base of the Great Pyramid. You know, and you wander through the streets of Nazlet al-Saman at night, if you listen carefully, you can hear the sound of picks and shovels in the basements. That's because everybody's got archaeology under their floor. That's why for a long time Zahi Hawass was trying to have Nazlet al-Saman bulldozed so that he could control that archaeology, but he's out of a job now. We're looking from the northeast, and we'll now circle round to the west side over the western desert here. And here you can understand why the ancients said that Egypt is the gift of the Nile, because this is the Nile Valley here. And there it's green and fertile and filled with life, but just go over a little bit to the west and you find yourself in the most unforgiving desert where hardly anything can live. The Great Pyramids stand at the edge of this on the escarpment overlooking the Nile Valley. And these are the northern faces of the three pyramids, the Pyramid of Menkaure, the Pyramid of Khafre, and the Pyramid of Khufu, as they are officially attributed, although I do not believe that they were made by any of those three pharaohs. Come closer, and here's the north face of the Great Pyramid with the original entrance and the entrance that was forced in the 9th century. Closer again, begin to get a sense of the scale of the project. Right at the top of the Great Pyramid, it's unfinished. There is no capstone on the Great Pyramid. That may have powerful symbolic meaning. There's about half a course of masonry on the south side. And closer again, and there am I, as a somewhat younger man, you know, before I was afflicted with osteoarthritis of the right hip, standing on top of the Great Pyramid of Giza. And it is, you know, it's a privilege. I am grateful for the chances that life has given me. And one of those chances was the chance to be on top of the Great Pyramid and to feel that power vibrating beneath your feet, and you realize that you're on top of the ultimate sacred monument, and that there is something magical about this place, and that whoever created this for whatever purpose, they absolutely knew what they were doing. It's like flying on a magic carpet above Cairo, you know. Well, you can see perhaps if you look closely at the pictures that at my feet and behind me, it's quite a lot of graffiti. People have this tendency to want to leave their names on things, which is one of the reasons why we have to say it's odd that Khufu did not leave his own name on the pyramid if he built it. But people like to leave their names on things, and a lot of people have climbed the Great Pyramid over the centuries and left their names on it, and one of them was Gerard Mercator, the great map maker, some of whose maps I'll be showing a little bit later. But just behind where I'm standing now, actually one step down, I like to tell this personal story. I found the name, very simply written, P. Hancock, 5th of April, 1916. My grandfather was called Philip Hancock, and he was a chaplain with British forces in Egypt in 1916. So I phoned my dad, he was alive at the time, and he had my grandfather's diaries, quite copious diaries. He used to write very lengthy entries. And I said, Dad, would you just get Grandpa's diary out of the drawer and check it for the 5th of April, 1916? He said, okay. I heard the papers rustling. And then he says, yeah, I've got it, but there's only one line here, which was very odd for Grandpa. So there's only one line here. I said, what does the line say? He said, climbed Great Pyramid today. So, you know, a personal connection there, and it really means something to me. When my father, many years later, was dying of cancer, Santa and I brought him to Giza. Unfortunately, he wasn't able to climb the Great Pyramid, but I know it meant a lot to him. So here it stands, 6 million tons, 481 feet high, 13-acre footprint. And just by chance, if you'll believe the Egyptologists, it's positioned on latitude 30, one-third of the way exactly between the equator and the North Pole. Of course, I don't believe it's chance at all. I think it's very deliberately positioned there because one of the things the Great Pyramid does is speak to our planet and speak of its connection with our planet. And therefore, it is positioned on a significant latitude, not a random latitude. And something else about this connection that you notice as you become familiar with it is its astonishing precision. That, you know, we don't bother much with modern monuments. If somebody wants to make a monument face north, they can make it face roughly north. It's not so difficult to do. Everybody knows where north, south, and east, and west are. But to take a 13-acre footprint monument weighing 6 million tons and align it to true north, you know, within 3/60ths of a single degree, that takes dedication. That takes skill. That is a really difficult thing to do. And you could imagine the modern architect saying to his client, well, I suppose I can do it, but why on earth would you go to that trouble and increase the cost by so much? But there it is, almost perfectly aligned to true north. And something else about the Great Pyramid, a little more subtle, a little more arcane, is that it is, in fact, a scale model of the northern hemisphere of the Earth. This isn't immediately apparent because it is, after all, a pyramid rather than a sphere. But it is, nonetheless, a scale model of the northern hemisphere of the Earth in terms of its dimensions. And that is because if you take the polar radius of the Earth, as we know it from modern science today, and multiply it by 43,200, you get, if you take the height of the Great Pyramid and multiply it by that, you get the polar radius of the Earth. The polar radius of the Earth is 43,200 times larger than the height of the Great Pyramid. And the equatorial circumference of the Earth is symbolized by the base perimeter of the Great Pyramid. Measure that, multiply it by 43,200, and you get the equatorial circumference of the Earth. So all those centuries and millennia, when our ancestors did not know the measurements of the Earth, all they ever had to do was measure the Great Pyramid, multiply by 43,200, and they would have got the answer. And weirdly, Isaac Newton, who spent a lot more time studying the Kabbalah than he spent studying physics, knew this because he sent John Greaves, a professor at Oxford University, to Egypt in the 1600s to measure the Great Pyramid because Isaac Newton was convinced the Great Pyramid did encode the dimensions of the Earth. Don't know how he knew that. Greaves couldn't do the measurement because the pyramid was too deeply covered up its sides in sand. But there it is. It is a scale model. Now, Egyptologists are also aware of this, and they also say it's a coincidence, total coincidence, just one of those accidents of mathematics and geometry. But you know, if it weren't 43,200, if it were like 57,640, I might agree. But 43,200 is not a random number. It's a number that belongs to a sequence of numbers that are found in mythology all around the world. And those numbers, very detailed study has revealed this, relate to a phenomenon called the precession of the equinoxes. Our planet is the viewing platform from which we observe the stars. And our planet has a very slow wobble on its axis. And that wobble is thought to be caused by the competing gravity of the sun and the moon. There may be other explanations which would result in the same observable. But the observable is there, there's no doubt about it, this precessional wobble, rather like what happens to a spinning top when you set it spinning fast and it slows down, and then the top begins to gyrate. And that gyration, as the pointer of the top does this, that is precession. It's most noticeable at the North Pole. If you extend the polar axis of the Earth up to the heavens, today it points at the star that we call Polaris, our pole star. But because of the precession, down over the millennia, that extended north pole of the Earth has actually pointed at different areas of space, sometimes at empty space, and sometimes at other stars. So other stars have occupied the position of pole star. Just happens to be Polaris today. The other place where it's most observable is at the horizon, where the sun rises. And what's noticeable is that the background stars behind the rising sun change position down the ages. These are the constellations of the zodiac, which lie on the path of the sun, 12 constellations of the zodiac. And because of the precession, we have been seeing the sun rise in the constellation of Pisces for the last 2,000 years. It's not an accident that the early Christians used the fish as their symbol. But before that, it was rising in the constellation of Aries. That's why we find so many references to rams in the Old Testament. And we're very soon to see the sun begin to rise in the constellation of Aquarius. That's why we live in the dawning of the age of Aquarius, as we all know. That's what that song is all about. Now, the connection of this to mythology was made clear by Giorgio de Santillana and Hertha von Deschend in a very arcane book called Hamlet's Mill. And very difficult book to read. I actually had to read it 5 times before I really got it. It was a kind of mind-bending exercise to get to grips with Hamlet's Mill, taking detailed notes. And when I finally really understood what they were saying, and the reason why these two academics, Giorgio de Santillana was a professor of history of science at MIT, mainstream academics had really encoded what they discovered in something that's almost impossible to read, because they were afraid of the reaction that it would cause amongst their colleagues. But they did sum it up in a little footnote hidden away, is that there was a detailed, precise knowledge of the precession of the equinoxes thousands of years before the Greeks, who it's handed to. It's thought we didn't know precession until about 2,000 years ago. They said it was thousands of years older than that, and they attributed it to, quote, some almost unbelievable ancestor civilization of remote antiquity. Now, the numbers that are involved all relate to the number 72. 72 is the key, because the precession of the equinoxes operates at the rate of 1 degree every 72 years. And 2,160 and 43,200 are all multiples of 72. And in ancient mythology, and many, many other numbers as well, you can take 72 and add half of 72 to it, you get 36, you get 108, divide that by 2, you get 54. These are all numbers that are derived from the precession. You can add zeros to them, but the basic numbers remain the same. And what Santillana and von Deschend show is that these numbers, these very specific numbers, are found in mythology all around the world, in mythology going back to the dawn of human history, in deeply ancient documents like the Rig Veda, in the story of Osiris, who is captured by Seth and his 72 assistants. The famous Mayan calendar also contains precessional numbers, built indeed around precessional numbers. And precession is not only present at Giza in the pyramid-earth ratio, but in other matters as well, which become even more intriguing. And the Great Sphinx plays its part in this sky-ground connection at Giza. The Great Sphinx, which again Egyptologists believe was built around 2500 BC, or rather I should not say built, but cut from solid rock. Those blocks that we see on the paws of the Great Sphinx are restoration blocks and relatively modern ones. Between the paws of the Sphinx stands a stela, which is also not from the time that the Sphinx was created. That stela was put there by Pharaoh Thutmosis IV, and it's called the Dream Stela, and it records a dream he had in the shadow of the Sphinx. In that stela, he refers to the Sphinx as marking what he calls the splendid place of the first time. The ancient Egyptians had this concept of the first time when the gods walked the earth. They called it Zeptepi. And it was considered to be very, very, very long ago, thousands and thousands of years ago. And the Sphinx is said to mark that point. Interesting. Now, Santa took this photograph from the back of the Sphinx. It's quite difficult, as anybody will know, who's been to Giza, to get up onto the back of the Sphinx, but we did manage it once or twice. And so Santa stood on the back of the Sphinx in daylight to take this photograph. That's the back of the Sphinx's head, and the Sphinx is looking east. Now, if you were to be there at dawn on the summer solstice, the 21st of June, the longest day of the year in the Northern Hemisphere, the sun would be rising way over here to the left of the gaze of the Sphinx, way over here to the left. And if you were to come at dawn on the winter solstice, the 21st of December, the sun would be rising far to the south of the east, way over here to the right of the Sphinx. But should you have the amazing good fortune to go there on the 21st of March, the spring equinox, when night and day are of equal length and the sun rises perfectly due east, this is what you will see. You will see the Sphinx gazing directly at the rising sun at dawn on the spring equinox. And the Sphinx is what is called an equinoctial marker. That is one of the things that it does. It marries heaven and earth on that particular day. Now, the precession does not affect the rising point of the sun on the horizon. The sun will always rise perfectly due east on the spring equinox. But what it does affect is the background stars behind the sun. Imagine yourself there an hour before dawn. The sky is dark. You see a constellation lying on the horizon. That constellation today, we're on the cusp between Pisces and Aquarius. And that is the constellation that's considered in ancient tradition to define the age, the epoch in which we live. And as I mentioned, because of the precession of the equinoxes, those changes, those constellations dance around behind the sun. And the dance takes place in the opposite direction of the annual cycle through the zodiac. So it goes Leo, Cancer, Gemini, Taurus, Aries, Pisces, and Aquarius. And each constellation houses the sun for 2,160 years. That's 30 times 72. We live now at the dawn of the age of Aquarius. My friend Robert Boval, with whom I've been privileged to write many books, has done more, I think, than anyone else to draw attention to the astronomical language of the Giza Plateau. And the fact that the three great pyramids on the ground represent three stars. In fact, the three stars of the belt of the constellation of Orion. But you can see it for yourselves whenever you go there at night and sense the sky above and the pyramids below and just see this. These are three stars brought down to Earth. But here's the mystery. With modern astronomical software, we can do what would have involved very intricate calculations for the ancients. We can work out exactly, we can know exactly how the stars looked over any point of the Earth's surface at any time in the past 30,000 years. And when you roll the skies back over Giza, you find that something extraordinary happens between 12,000 and 13,000 years ago, between 10,000 BC and 11,000 BC. And it's perfect at around 10,500 BC, but really there's very little change in a 1,000-year period in the positions of the stars. And it happens at dawn on the spring equinox, when the Sphinx is gazing due east at the rising sun, then housed by the constellation of Leo, because this was the age of Leo. The Sphinx's own celestial counterpart is rising in the heavens. And the constellation of Orion at that very moment is lying due south on the horizon at the meridian, with its three belt stars mirrored by the pattern of the three great pyramids on the ground. And even... Yeah, the Sphinx is looking at his own celestial counterpart, or rather her own celestial counterpart. The Sphinx is looking at a lion in the sky. And that's one of the points that I want to make is that if the Sphinx was built in 2500 BC, they should have built it in the shape of a bull, because that was the age of Taurus. It doesn't make sense to build it in the shape of a lion unless you're building it 12,500 years ago. Unless the Sphinx is actually 10,000 years older than the Egyptologists think it is. That's why this diagram is so intriguing. And very strangely, the Nile and the Milky Way also line up. The Milky Way that the ancient Egyptians called the Winding Waterway. Now, I'm not saying that whoever created the Giza monuments put the Nile there. But I am suggesting that one of the reasons that site was chosen was because the Nile was there. in that pattern, and that it lent itself to the creation of this extraordinary diagram. That the site is speaking to the date that we call 10,500 BC, or the epoch between 10,000 and 11,000 BC. Now, I don't want to take the whole of the Giza Plateau away from the ancient Egyptians. The ancient Egyptians saw themselves as the inheritors of the gods of the first time. They saw themselves as receiving a legacy of wisdom from the past and of extending and expressing that wisdom in their age. And the ancient Egyptians had a great deal to do with the Giza Plateau. But I am suggesting that the Giza Plateau has remotely ancient origins, and that whereas the ancient Egyptians may have finished the pyramids, work had already begun on the pyramids long, long before that. And one of the places that I'm certain is prehistoric is the subterranean chamber, which lies directly beneath the apex of the pyramid, deep under the earth, in the original primeval mound around which the Great Pyramid is built. I would say that the subterranean chamber is definitely 12,000 plus years old. And I would say that the same goes for the Great Sphinx and for the temples, the megalithic temples that surround it. These are part of the first phase of construction at Giza, dating back to the time that the ancient Egyptians called Zeptepi the first time. And my colleague Robert Schock and John Anthony West were the first back in the early 1990s to expose the precipitation-induced weathering on the body of the Sphinx and on the trench that surrounds it, that these deep vertical fissures can only be the result of exposure to thousands of years of heavy rainfall. And you have to go back to the end of the last ice age to get that kind of heavy rainfall. It has not fallen in Giza in the last 5,000 years. So when the notion of a radically older Sphinx was being put before the public in the early 1990s, Egyptology and their friends in geology reacted with horror to the notion and said that any of us who were claiming that the Sphinx was 12,000 or more years old were obviously completely insane, because there was no other monument anywhere in the world that was 12,000 years old. Our ancestors 12,000 years ago were in the Upper Paleolithic. They were simple Stone Age hunter-gatherers. How could we be so ridiculous as to imagine that they could create anything on the scale of the Great Sphinx? Show me one other monument, one of those archaeologists thundered, which is 12,000 years old, and I might listen to you, but there is no such thing. That was the early 1990s. Well, there is such a thing now, and it's in Turkey, and it's called Göbekli Tepe. And you know what? A mainstream archaeologist found it, and he's called Klaus Schmidt, and he's with the German Archaeological Institute in Turkey. And he's done very thorough and detailed work, and it is clear that this megalithic site, which dwarfs Stonehenge, with megaliths of 20 plus tons, arranged in circles over an enormous scale with many more under the ground that yet remain to be excavated, is 12,000 and more years old. And furthermore, that it was deliberately buried like a time capsule about 10,000 years ago to await discovery in a later age. It's been discovered now. And apart from a few articles here and there, it's amazing how quiet the world of archaeology has kept about Göbekli Tepe, because Göbekli Tepe truly is a bomb. It is the fingerprints of a lost civilization. You can't create something like this, you know, without a background. You have to have experience. You have to have knowledge of working and moving stone. And there it sits, the oldest stuff the best, 12,000 years old, coming out of nowhere, just appearing suddenly. Well, of course, there's a background to it, and of course, it provides a context for the Sphinx. And we now have to consider that other monuments around the world may have been misunderstood. Göbekli Tepe opens the door to that, perhaps even the famous monuments of Easter Island, which are thought to be, you know, 1,400 years old at most, maybe even less than 1,000 years old. Is it possible that these gigantic statues belong to an earlier epoch? and that a later culture came along and re-erected some of them on relatively simple platforms, leaving others on the ground. Easter Island is a magical and wonderful place. And if you go up to Ranuraruku Crater, you'll find a whole forest of heads sticking out of the ground. And you might imagine that, you know, they're just buried by a few feet, because if they're only 1,000 years old, sedimentation would only bury them, you know, by a few feet. But actually, Thor Heyerdahl excavated some of these statues back in 1955, and that's what he found, that they go down 30 feet under the ground. And Robert Schock has recently been there, the geologist from Boston University who did the work on the Sphinx, and he's calculated that that sedimentation has taken thousands of years to come into position. And there's something else as well, maybe a coincidence, may not, is here's Göbekli Tepe, and this big megalith has actually got hands carved into it, and those hands cross in front of the belly like that, just as do the hands of this statue here, and this statue here. Very, very curious. And there's something else at Easter Island, which is up on the Orongo headland, where you find the Birdman effigies. This bird figure carved into the rock, part human, part bird. I can't quite see it over there, but there it is. And an island offshore where there was an ancient ritual where the islanders would swim out to bring back an egg from the island. And the same symbology of the Birdman also appears at Göbekli Tepe, complete with an egg. I think at the very least there's something that requires further investigation going on here. That's where Göbekli Tepe sits in Turkey. And it looks tremendously like gigantic stone circles that are found on the island of Malta, where Santa and I have done a great deal of work. This one is called Menhydra. And the archaeologists date the Menhydra stone circles, temples, to about 5,000 years ago, a little bit older than Stonehenge. And they get very upset if you suggest that they might have got things wrong, and that the megalithic structures of Malta may be much, much older than that, like Hagar Im. See, today when we need to move around those megaliths, we have to use cranes and high technology, but somehow in deep antiquity, the work was done without that technology. So Malta is known for its sun and sand, but it does have this amazing megalithic culture that's really worth paying attention to. And of all the Maltese structures, the one that I find most fascinating is the Hypogeum, which is actually underground, carved out of solid rock, with these amazing full curves cut into the rock walls with gateways and tunnels and passageways. Very, very beautiful place. And there's something, a place of meditation for sure. There's something about those curves which is reminiscent of some of the statues that are found on Malta, which are of goddess figures, the mother goddess. These statues are found all over Malta, and the archaeologists, again, want them to be no more than 5,000 years old. It would be difficult for them if they were more than 5,000 years old, since they insist that the temples have to be 5,000 years old. But actually, the goddess figure as a notion is far, far older than that. We know that it's an Upper Paleolithic notion, that it goes back 26, 30, even 40, close to 40,000 years old, these goddess figures. So is it possible that the Maltese goddess figures are actually that old, much, much older than they're said to be? I'm inside the Hypogeum here, and on the ceiling above me are faded imagery in red ochre. And there's more of those images. But it wasn't just patterns. Up until a few years ago, there was painted in ochre on the walls of the Hypogeum a creature that is referred to as the bison bull. A typical Upper Paleolithic cave painting, actually. But there it is on the walls of the Hypogeum until the director of the National Museums of Malta came along and scrubbed it off the walls. And this has been exposed by an amateur archaeologist called Anton Mifsud, who happens to be the chief pediatrician at the main hospital in Malta, but a very dedicated amateur archaeologist. And he's got the evidence for this, and he dug it out, and he presented it, and he had me present the evidence to the Malta museums, and I sum up there's the letter that I wrote to them there on the screen. And we pushed this evidence at them again and again and again, and they just stonewalled it and refused to comment. They didn't even come back and say, no, it didn't, it never happened. They just shut up completely. So a terrible crime took place against archaeology in that place, largely because it would have suggested that the Hypogeum was thousands of years older than archaeology wants it to be. Also of the same period are these cart ruts, which archaeologists also want to be about 5,000 years old. Some cart, I have to say. Some rut. I'm sitting there with Anton Mifsud, who exposed that scandal. Through him we learned that local divers had discovered cart ruts underwater, going deep underwater. So Santa and I got on our diving gear and went down with them. And indeed it turns out to be true that the cart ruts do continue underwater in places that have been submerged definitely for more than 12,000 years. So suddenly the whole story of the dating of Malta, I believe, needs to be looked at again. This amazing site, now to jump to the other side of the world, is in Japan. It's not widely known that Japan has an ancient megalithic culture, but this monument called Ishibutai, which Santa photographed during the cherry blossom season, is one of the megalithic sites of Japan, a major tourist attraction today. Nobody knows how old it is, but it's built on a gigantic scale. And up here on the mountainside near Asuka is this curious megalith, which they call Masado no Iwafune, the upside-down boat stone. Nobody knows how long that's there either. As far as records go back, it's referred to, but nobody knows who put it there or when. Beautifully carved on the top, but when you go around behind the structure, you can see how the stonemasons did their work, that they cut it out in these H-shaped grooves, and had they finished the job off, they would have cut away the areas that stick out and would have left it completely smooth. We found evidence of exactly the same stone cutting technique 110 feet underwater off the coast of Japan. At Yonaguni. Again, those H-shaped grooves. And this, we know, has been submerged for more than 12,000 years. So it's beginning to raise the question that some of the megaliths above water in Japan may be more than 12,000 years old. I'm going to take you on a quick visit to Yonaguni, which is the most southwestern of all the Japanese islands, down near Taiwan, where Santa and I have been privileged to put in somewhere between 200 and 300 dives over a period of years, trying to wrestle with the archaeologists over the underwater monuments of Yonaguni. It's interesting how archaeologists and geologists who've never been there and just look at photographs easily dismiss Yonaguni as a totally natural phenomenon. But when you dive on it hundreds of times, and when you improve your diving skills to the level where you can actually deal with enormous currents that operate in that area. Because most people who go diving there, one geologist we took there who had not learned to dive properly, spent his entire time just fighting for his life, not studying the monuments at all. So I want to take you on a slow journey through some of the less impressive and some of the more impressive aspects of the underwater site at Yonaguni. And it starts off here, where we have, between two parallel walls, a curved walkway. And as we swim east from here, we come to a tunnel. And I'm just swimming through that tunnel there. That's my fins in the back of the tunnel. But if you look what's inside the tunnel, you find that it consists of two gigantic megalithic blocks on each side, placed one on top of the other. And when you emerge from the tunnel, you find yourself confronted by two parallel blocks of stone, each weighing about 100 tons, which are laid into a niche in the side of the rock face. The orthodox opinion is that these fell into place from a cliff overhead. The fact that there is no cliff right overhead doesn't deter the archaeologists at all. That they just were nicely slotted in there without the hand of man, because if the hand of man is involved, we have a problem with history. Now, those two megaliths stand against the side of a huge rocky outcrop, and that rocky outcrop is undoubtedly natural, but it is shaped by man as you continue further around and come to the beautiful terraces of Yonaguni. All of which our archaeological friends would like to be completely natural. They have an elaborate theory for why these steps are natural. They think that that this is a sort of sedimentary rock, and that as the sea beat against it, it selectively removed the softer areas, leaving the harder areas in place, which just happened to end up looking like steps. Well, if the sea did that, I mean, I do actually understand what they're getting at, but you know, where you see like these here at Cuzco in Peru, nobody's saying that that's natural, you know. But here in Yonaguni, well, why, this has to be natural, because if it's not natural, it's more than 12,000 years old, and that's a real problem. So anyway, if the sea did amazingly do that by taking out the softer areas of rock to create this platform, we would expect to find all that rock down here in the drop-off that lies below. But actually what we find in that drop-off is a perfectly clear path lying at the bottom of the Yonaguni monument. And all the rubble has been nicely cleared to one side. And that to me says the hand of man, definitely not the hand of nature. One of the other strange anomalous imagery that were found in Mexico alongside those bearded Caucasian faces are the distinctively African faces, the famous Olmec heads. And I've placed one here for perspective beside this underwater face that's found at Yonaguni, which has two eyes, a nose, and a mouth. Just want you to take a look at that underwater face, which actually is oriented perfectly due south. It's on an enormous scale. It's quite an awesome place to dive, actually. And when you get close to the eyes, you find that they have pupils in them. And those Olmec heads all wore headdresses. And a very similar headdress is found on this underwater face down here. You can see the remains of the headdress quite clearly in this picture, just around there. And my goodness, if nature did all of this, it certainly went to great lengths to define the head from the outcrop out of which it emerges, and helpfully cleared away everything around it so that there was a complete sort of ceremonial platform in the area. Japan has stone circles too. A couple of stone circles shown here. The larger ones are not so large, and they're also very small ones made of little river stones placed on the ground, dated to around 4,000 to 5,000 years old. But underwater off Japan, there's a gigantic stone circle, one of the most impressive monuments I've dived on anywhere in the world, and it's off the coast of Okinawa. In the southwest of Japan. Yonaguni's down here, here's Okinawa, and off the Kerama group of islands, at a depth of 110 feet, you come to this huge stone circle underwater, which interestingly has those little river stone circles clustered around it as well, exactly like you find in the sites that are supposed to be 4,000 years old, above water. This too is a difficult dive. Sometimes we've had to wait there for 5 or 6 days to be able to get down on it. The sea's been so bad, the currents have been so intense, you just get swept away and find yourself suddenly half a mile away from where you mean to be diving. But on this occasion, when Santa took this photograph and I'm there holding the video camera, as you can see from the bubbles, there was no current and it was very calm. It gives you a sense of the scale of the thing, and the way that we have a central upright surrounded by surrounding megaliths, all carved out of solid rock. No way on earth the sea did this. And the way, for example, that the outer megalith here, the inner curve matches the outer curve of the central upright. Really quite striking. So let's remind ourselves of the position of Southeast Asia at the end of the last ice age, 21,300 years ago. And we see that the island of Taiwan was actually joined onto mainland China at that time, as I suspect mainland China would still wish it to be today. And interestingly, Taiwan, which is very near to Yonaguni, has a mysterious megalithic culture. There are megaliths all over the island of Taiwan, quite striking ones. Nobody knows how old they are either. But we went there because local divers drew our attention to an underwater wall lying off the west of Taiwan. And that's that wall, very imposing structure with battlements, with a patio in front of it. And when you get up close, you find that this is no natural feature, that this is made of individual blocks of stone which have been put into position to create the wall. So I've spoken of Japan and Taiwan, and now I want to talk a little bit about ancient maps. Because there's one ancient map dating to the 1400s, which was drawn up from copying older source maps, and which also incorporates certain prejudices of the 1400s, which is really weird, because this map shows us the Atlantic Ocean. It's the Atlantic Ocean over there. And that's Spain there. That's Spain over there in the Mediterranean Sea and North Africa, the coast of North Africa coming down here. But in the Atlantic Ocean are positioned these two huge islands called Satanase and Antilia, which don't exist in the Atlantic Ocean. In those days, for those few people who did credit the world with being round, the notion was that if you sailed west from Spain, you would come to Asia. You would come to China. That's what Columbus believed when he set sail. He believed he was going to discover China, going to come a new route to China. And as is well known, two large island systems lie off the coast of China, and those are Japan and Taiwan. And that's what these two islands show. They show Japan and Taiwan, but mislocated, according to the prejudices of the time, into the Atlantic Ocean. Robert Fuson, the professor of geography at South Florida University, has clearly established that these are images of Japan and Taiwan. But what he didn't get into is images of Japan and Taiwan when. And let's look first at Antilia. Here's Taiwan as it looks today, but here's how it looked 12,400 years ago, with a distinct little island lying off to the west side, near where that wall we dived on is. And there's Taiwan, and there's Antilia, and that distinct island is shown in exactly the right place on the Antilia map, not as it looked in 1424, but as it looked 12,400 years ago. And Japan was one island during the Ice Age, not the three main islands, but one island, with a deep inlet here and here, exactly as we see on this image of Satanase. So it seems that somehow these maps are preserving imagery of Japan and Taiwan as they looked during the last ice age. Well, here's map-making technology of the Middle Ages. Very beautiful, but you don't want to navigate by it. These are called the T-O maps from their O-T shape. And the T is actually, what happens in these maps is the east is up. So this is actually the Mediterranean Sea here. And this is the Holy Land. This is Palestine. Up here at the top of the maps. And then you have the Nile River system going off down into Africa here, at this side, and North Africa and Europe and Spain. And that was it. That was map-making technology in the 700s, the 800s, the 900s. So suddenly, around the late 1200s, there was a flood of map-making knowledge entered the world. And that flood of map-making knowledge almost certainly was because an archive of ancient maps that probably originally had come from the Library of Alexandria, that had been taken to Constantinople, now known as Istanbul, were liberated during the Crusades. And the mariners of the time grabbed these maps and started making copies of them, and at the same time started imposing their own prejudices upon the copies that they were making. And two different traditions seem to be related to this moment. One is the what's called the Ptolemaic geographic tradition. Ptolemy was a known figure who worked at the Library of Alexandria, and his coordinates emerged into public consciousness again in the 1300s. And the other is the so-called Portolan tradition, which comes out. And these are maps, mainly maps of Europe now. The world maps seem to have been thrown away, which incorporate astonishingly accurate latitudes and longitudes. And the great work on this was done by Charles Hapgood in his Maps of the Ancient Sea Kings, a book that I would highly recommend everybody to read. But I just want to take a look at a few of these anomalous maps, like this Waldseemüller world map of 1507, which shows Southeast Asia vastly extended and not as it appears today, but rather as it appeared at the end of the last ice age. And the famous Piri Reis map, source of much controversy. You can see that there's a large island up here, roughly off the coast of the United States, where Florida is, this large island here. And I don't know if you can see that on that large island is depicted a row of stone blocks running right up the middle of the island. But those stone blocks, I'm fairly sure that island doesn't exist today. Those stone blocks, I'm fairly sure, are the Bimini Road, the famous Bimini Road that we have dived on many times. The other feature of the Piri Reis map is, again, controversial, that it seems to show Antarctica, that the southern tip of South America is extended down into another landmass. And Piri Reis tells us in his own handwriting on the map that he based this map on 100 older source maps that he copied from, he compiled and put together. Antarctica, the problem is, was not discovered by our culture until 1818, was unknown to our explorers until the early 19th century. So here's Antarctica as we know it today, but maps that were not based on copies of older source maps, maps based on current knowledge from the early 1800s, show Antarctica like this, as nothing. There's just nothing there at the South Pole at all. So it's weird that when you go back some hundreds of years before that, to the 16th, 15th, 14th centuries, you find maps that show Antarctica pretty accurately. And what all these maps have in common is that they are based on older source maps, now lost to us. That's the Orontius Finnius map, and here's one of those Mercator maps, again showing Antarctica. And even some astonishing details, like this little island off the coast of Ireland, shown on a 1513 map, this little island off the coast of Ireland here called High Brazil. You'd need a time machine if you wanted to discover that island in 1513, or indeed today. But it did exist in exactly the right place between 12 and 13,000 years ago. That's when it was submerged at the end of the last ice age. So go back to Giza. They seem to be using precessional astronomy, which changes at the rate of 1 degree every 72 years, with monumental architecture to draw attention to that epoch between 10,000 and 11,000 BC. 1 degree every 72 years. Now today, for historical reasons, we draw the prime meridian of the Earth through Greenwich in England. And it's difficult to notice the relationship of sites around the world with that prime meridian. But as I was doing my research, I discovered that actually the site of Angkor in Cambodia does lie precisely 72 degrees of longitude east of Giza. And that immediately becomes apparent if you just shift the prime meridian and draw it through Giza instead, as I believe it was the ancient prime meridian of the Earth. And actually, many other sites around the world also fall on that grid, where there are mysterious ancient monuments, such as Tahiti, such as Easter Island. In a way, Easter Island is the exception that proves the rule, because Easter Island today is about 200 miles off that grid. But if you go back to the end of the last ice age, you find it was part of a huge archipelago, the largest island of which sat precisely on the grid. And Pohnpei in Micronesia and Tiruvannamalai in India are also on the grid. Tiruvannamalai, where there's a tradition that wise men took shelter after the flood to preserve and pass on human knowledge to the future, where we find astonishing pyramidal temples and memories of the time before the flood. And just off the coast of India, not far from Tiruvannamalai, we find interesting underwater ruins at Pumpahar and at Mahabalipuram. It was very difficult for Santa to get good pictures at Pumpahar because the water is very dirty, even down at 100 feet underwater in areas that have been submerged for more than 12,000 years. But this is undoubtedly a man-made structure, and we've had this confirmed by the Indian Archaeological Institute. A man-made structure that's been submerged for more than 12,000 years off the coast of India, with large blocks of stone lying on the seabed. And go further north from Pumpahar to Mahabalipuram, where you find rock-cut temples standing on shore. You also find fishermen who are really quite upset about the huge underwater city that lies off the coast, because they keep catching their nets on it, and they keep having to send down free divers, often in difficult circumstances, to free the nets, and people get killed. It happens that Santa's first language is Tamil, so we were able to have long conversations with these fishermen, going way back to 1992, actually. And they convinced us that they were telling the truth. And we said to them, have you spoken, for example, to archaeologists about this? And they said, we have, but nobody believes us. And then we found that there was a legend of the seven pagodas, that there had been there were ancient legends that spoke of a city that had been flooded by the sea when the gods became angry with it for its cruelty and arrogance, rather like the story of Atlantis. So finally, in 2002, we were able to set up an expedition. And as you can see, it's a very high-tech expedition. And with the Scientific Exploration Society in Britain. And off we went to Mahabalipuram, and we asked the fishermen, tell us where to dive. And they said, dive here. So we dived there, and immediately we found their city. We found huge blocks of stone. We found walls, some submerged in sand, lying under the seabed, and extending over vast distances, up to 5 kilometers out from shore. There I'm putting my dive knife between two of those blocks of stone. And we had Indian archaeologists with us, actually diving with us. And this is a city, you know. So we thought that this was going to be the beginning of a new epoch of exploration. But it wasn't. Actually, what happened was it profoundly embarrassed the Indian archaeologists that foreigners had been involved in making this discovery. And we weren't allowed to go back and dive there anymore. And the whole thing just stopped dead until the Boxing Day tsunami, when the bay in front of Mahabalipuram was emptied out for half an hour, and many people saw the city underwater. They couldn't keep quiet about it any longer. And since then, there has been some very low-level research going on. But to my intense frustration, that research is taking place only in the intertidal zone, down to depths of 15 feet. And they're not going out 5 kilometers where we've seen these amazing, complicated structures. So again and again, we are a species with amnesia, and those who are responsible for memorizing our past keep on covering it up. Like in the Gulf of Cambay, up here, where side-scan sonar shows the remains of two huge cities underwater at a depth of more than 120 feet. Gigantic rectilinear structures on the bed of the sea. Again, 2002, up till today, no diving whatsoever has been allowed on the site. I don't get it. Let's just jump over to Pohnpei in Micronesia on the grid over here, the site of Nan Madol, very famous, beautiful temples above water on the island of Pohnpei in Micronesia. But these structures that we see above water also continue underwater into this bay. And they initially look like the structures above water. But as you dive deeper and deeper down to 120 feet beneath the water, and as the water gets murkier and murkier, enormous columns and pillars start to appear. And that's when you think about the local legend as this silty water is in your face. That's when you start to think about the local legend of the underwater city that's guarded by two gigantic sharks. And you think of those sharks coming at you out of the murk and the gloom. And so it continues. Columns and pillars underwater, some of them fallen. And this fallen column greatly resembling megalithic architecture on the island of Tinian, which is in the same general vicinity and was in fact the island from which the American nuclear raids on Japan were launched. Those are the megaliths on the island of Tinian. I'm suggesting that the whole megalithic culture of the Pacific may have been radically misinterpreted and that we may be looking at something much, much older than we believe we're looking at. Let's finally go to Angkor, 72 degrees of longitude east of Giza, that significant number, where we find 72 major temples, all of them orthodoxly dated to just over 1,000 years ago. And I don't actually dispute that dating. What's happened at Angkor is that temples have been built on temples have been built on temples. This site has been sacred since time immemorial. And what we're looking at when we look at the temples of Angkor today is the latest incarnations of a much, much, much more ancient tradition. Like the famous Angkor Wat. Again, Santa got this photograph from a military helicopter. Pretty scary ride, I have to say. Something out of Apocalypse Now, actually, just flying. As you can see, Angkor Wat is pyramidal in form. And running through it is this amazing east-west axis. This is the east side over here. That's the west side over there, which just continues across the moat and then disappears off over the horizon kilometers away. A perfectly straight line. Now, if you position yourself on this causeway, on the west side of the causeway, looking east at dawn on the spring equinox. Remember, dawn on the spring equinox is the day when the great Sphinx marries heaven and earth, looking at the rising sun. Well, position yourself on that causeway at Angkor before dawn, and this is what happens. The sun first peeps over the corner of the tower, then it starts to rise up the central tower, and then finally it sits on top of the central tower. And the whole place, you know, lights up like a fairy tale kingdom. And you realize that that's what this was built to do. It was built to unite heaven and earth on that special day. A magical, enchanted moment takes place. And here's the interesting thing about Angkor, which again my colleagues in Egyptology will not accept, is that when you actually draw lines between the principal temples on the ground, you find that they look like a constellation in the sky. And that constellation is the constellation of Draco the dragon. And dragon serpent symbolism is the most common symbolism at Angkor. And furthermore, with astronomical software, we can tell that it's Draco not in 1100 AD, but Draco at dawn on the spring equinox in 10,500 BC, exactly the same as we find at Giza. And this notion of using the stars and architecture to speak to certain dates is not even alien to our own culture. We actually do that. And we do it for the reasons I believe it was done at Giza and Angkor, that any human language may become extinct, that we may not be able to read that language, like we can't read the Indus Valley script today. If you want to speak across the millennia, you want a universal language. You want a language that can be understood in any time. And that's the language of astronomy. Now, as I say, the stellar positions changed very little over 1,000 years. This is drawing our attention to the window between 12,000 and 13,000 years ago, between 10,000 BC and 11,000 BC. And enormous effort was put into it. And are we being told that something of great significance for the world happened in this period? Perhaps something that led to the destruction of a great global civilization? Is this the work of the survivors? Something that's meant to pass down knowledge in some way? I've felt for a long time that that's the case. But one of the reasons when I spoke of cataclysm 12, 13,000 years ago that I came in for a lot of criticism is that archaeologists said, well, look, yes, we know it was the end of the last ice age. It was a bad time. But what's special about 12 to 13,000 years ago? What really big thing happened then that you really would make people sit up and pay attention? I couldn't answer that question until 1997, when evidence of a massive cometary impact in precisely that period came to light, evidence derived by mainstream science. Sorry, 2007. Not 1997. 2007 is when this evidence came out. Huge geographical features of North America, the Carolina Bays, for example, are impact craters. That some kind of fragmented comet exploded over North America and Canada and created a gigantic global cataclysm, leaving distinct microspherules on the ground, which are the signature of a cometary impact. That happened around 12,900 years ago, in other words, exactly in that window of 12 to 13,000 years ago. When this evidence first came out, the team who presented it were immediately attacked by their geological colleagues. And for a long time, there was doubt over the evidence. Another group of scientists went and tried to find those microspherules, and they used a certain kind of sieve, and they couldn't find the microspherules. But that was because the sieve was too big, and the microspherules were falling through it. And now the whole research has been reviewed again by a multinational team, and they're now really quite sure that it did happen, that there was, this is from 2012, and that there was a gigantic cometary impact over North America and Canada roughly 12,900 years ago. And that impact created what we would call a nuclear winter today, that it threw up so much dust into the atmosphere that the sun's rays were bounced back off into the heavens, and that the Earth, which had been coming out of the Ice Age, went back into a deep freeze. And that's why we have the phenomenon that geologists call the Younger Dryas, 1,000 years of radical, inexplicable refreezing at the end of the last Ice Age. 70% of all animal species went extinct during that period. And it's impossible to believe that our ancestors were not radically affected by it. It might perhaps even have got rid of an entire global civilization. We know about fragmenting comets. Everybody knows or should remember about Shoemaker-Levy 9, which collided with Jupiter spectacularly in 1994, a sort of cosmic freight train of fragments of a comet torn into pieces, which bombarded Jupiter in a most spectacular way. I think we should all be incredibly deeply grateful for the planet Jupiter. Thank you, Jupiter. Who is the giant guardian of life on this planet. Not by accident that the ancients called Jupiter a god. With its huge gravity and its enormous dimensions circling in the outer solar system, what Jupiter does is it sweeps up those comets and asteroids that would otherwise make life on Earth impossible. It protects us from those bombardments. But every now and then, as we know, despite all the efforts of Jupiter, a comet or an asteroid gets through. The KT event that resulted in the extinction of the dinosaurs 65 million years ago, for example. And we can now say a gigantic cometary impact 12,900 years ago. And the more I look at this, the more I find it intriguing when we look at these star maps, because there is a resonance between the sky of 12,500 years ago and the sky of today. And it relates to the phenomenon of precession. And I started to wonder, were they not only drawing our attention to something that happened in that window between 12 and 13,000 years ago, but also saying, and it might come back? Because there is such a phenomenon as the long period comet. A long period comet can easily have an orbit of 12,000 or more years. What goes around comes around. And the odd thing about these two skies is that then Orion was at its lowest point on its precessional journey, and Draco was at its highest point. Then Leo was rising in the east, and Aquarius was setting in the west, all this at the spring equinox. Now today, Orion's at its highest point, and Draco's at its lowest point. And Leo's setting in the west, and Aquarius is rising in the east. It's like the two skies have flipped around half a precessional cycle later. And I can't help thinking, suppose the date that comet struck was 10,948 BC. Half a precessional cycle would bring you exactly to 2012, to the Mayan calendar. And I started to wonder, maybe, suppose some fragments of that comet are still in orbit. Is that what they're trying to tell us, that something's coming back? I mean, how, you can't be so exact in the science, but long-period comets are worrying. And comets do fragment. That's why I think it's really interesting that a very recent discovery has been made in the skies. And that discovery is of a new comet coming our way. And actually, it's not the 21st of December 2012, but over 12,000 years, it's pretty close. Next November, the brightest object in our night sky will be this comet. And the good news is, it's going to miss. It's not the end of the world. Fortunately. Of course, we have to reserve some caution because comets don't become visible until they outgas, and they outgas close as they come closer to the sun. We have to reserve the possibility that some fragments of that comet may not be yet outgassing, but I don't believe it's the end of the world. And I don't actually believe that the Mayan calendar was predicting the end of the world when it drew attention to the 21st of December 2012. We are in this hazardous cosmos, but perhaps the greatest danger to the human race is posed by ourselves and by our own incredible stupidity and our own attraction to evil and wickedness, which it is of vital importance that we resist. No, what the Mayan calendar was speaking of was not the end of the world, but the end of a cycle. The end of a great cycle in the human story. And it's very interesting if you look at the Mayan calendar, the long count, it actually runs for a period of 5,126 years. And that's from 3,114 BC to 2012 AD. And when it comes to an end, a new cycle immediately begins on the 22nd of December, 2012. And in the Mayan way of thinking, you would not expect that to mark the end of the world, but you would expect that it speaks to some kind of change that's underway in the human story right now. And what's interesting about these dates is that if you go back to 3000 BC, that's the beginning of a particular period of the human story. That's when the first great cities are built, as far as we know. That's when we get the birth of the hierarchical, centrally dominant, organized religions. That's when we get the beginnings of the notions of the great corporations. I would say the last 5,000 years have been the epoch of the big, centralized, hierarchical, dominant organization. And I actually think the Maya are right. That epoch is coming to an end. That model is broken. And that model has brought the world and the human future close to destruction. What is key about we human beings, what makes us different from other animals on this planet, what makes us special, our special gift and our special curse, is that we have the power of choice. We can choose. We can write our own future. We don't have to be passive in the face of the horrors that we confront in the world today. And what I see waking up all around the world is indeed the birth of a new human consciousness. I do think we live at the beginning of a new epoch. I am actually enormously optimistic for the future, not pessimistic at all. I think that we do live in a dark time. We do stand on the edge of an abyss. But we don't have to step over it, and we can put the lights back on. And many of us, you know, confronted by the wickedness and cruelty of the world, feel powerless as to what can we do, what can I do, what can I, a single individual, do to change anything of of all those gigantic horrors out there. And it's true, actually, that it's difficult as an individual to change big structures. But you know what's not difficult as an individual? And that's the decisions and the choices you make about your own life. There we are powerful indeed. There we may choose one path or the other. We may choose to live for love if we want to. It's up to us. And that's what I think is missing, most missing from the world. Not a shortage of oil, not a shortage of water, not a shortage of money or of any natural resource. It's a shortage of love. That's what's missing in the world. And that's what each one of us have the sovereignty in our own lives to make the right choice to do, to live with love. And loving is giving. And to make our own little sphere a better place tomorrow than it was yesterday. And if every one of us does that and makes those choices and wakens up to the sacred gift we've been given to live on this planet, then I think the future will be bright indeed. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm very honored to have Graham Hancock with me here today, and we are at the 12-12-12 conference in Arkansas, and Graham, welcome, and thank you so much for the presentation you just made.
Thank you.
You spoke a lot about the parallel dimensions, mm-hmm. about visionary plants, mm-hmm. and I certainly have had a similar path in which...
So interesting that we've been on this parallel track.
Well, yeah, I lived outside the United States a great number of years and spent 9 years in South America. And I had the opportunity to try ayahuasca mm-hmm. in Bolivia, and it had a profound effect on me. And certainly wasn't recreational, but it opened me up to view the truth. I saw many of the things about myself that I needed to correct.
And exactly the same experience with me. I encountered ayahuasca initially because I was researching a book,
yes.
and I've always been a hands-on researcher. Mm-hmm. That's why I spent 6 or 7 years scuba diving, looking for underwater ruins.
Right.
And when it came to the impact of altered states of consciousness on human evolution and on the human story, it was obvious that I had to go and experience those states of consciousness myself, and I chose to work with shamans in the Amazon jungle. And what began as a research project transformed into a life's work for me, because when I drank ayahuasca, it had a transformatory effect on me. And I realized, although it's very difficult and very painful sometimes, the experience, both physically and emotionally, that I was learning important lessons from it, and that I needed to learn those lessons.
Did you have the deep experience the first time that you did?
No, I didn't. It took a few sessions
right.
Before I started to have what I would describe as really deep experiences, which charged me and faced me with things that I needed to deal with, and also opened up for me what I could only describe as seamlessly convincing parallel realms,
right.
where I encountered other intelligences that were communicating with me telepathically. This did not happen overnight. It was work, and I think actually it's often the case that ayahuasca has not with everybody, but ayahuasca has work to do with our bodies,
yes.
first,
yeah.
Before it reveals those realms, and we need to cleanse and purify.
Well, it's interesting. In my case, I told a brief story about how a coincidence occurred where I met a shaman in Bolivia, mm-hmm. not the one that I was necessarily
necessarily originally looking for, but turned out to be someone that I felt a lot of connection to, and is an absolute master.
Right.
And the first time that I did it, I did have the experience, and he didn't expect that to occur. Yeah. The same thing happened when I went back 6 months later. But what happened that first time was, in many ways, like what my Christian upbringing would describe as the judgment. I went through an entire process of feeling the pain and hurt from the source, from, you know, from people that I'd hurt, from their perspective.
Yeah.
And went through my entire life that way, and then the reverse, where everyone that had ever hurt me or programmed me, particularly my father, I spent a lot of time releasing, but it felt like real time.
Yeah.
And I was so happy when I started waking up to realize that I was still alive,
yes.
I still had a chance,
absolutely.
And I could get it right. And
absolutely,
when I came out of that experience, I made phone calls to people to
yes.
let them know, you know, 35 years ago, I did something with you that I'm not proud of.
Please forgive me.
Please forgive me.
Yeah, yeah. I've been through that same process myself. Over the years, I first started drinking ayahuasca in late 2003, and since then, it's been an almost yearly practice for me. I've had about 40 sessions with ayahuasca. You know, I learn something new every time, and that judgment, that sense of being in the judgment, or what you know might be called the hall of judgment in the ancient Egyptian tradition, that came through strongest to me really quite recently, just a year or so ago, in Brazil in a series of five sessions. I had. Prior to that, already had many realizations that I wasn't perhaps such a nice guy as I thought I was, and that I had caused pain, and that I needed forgiveness, and that also there were people to forgive. But in terms of a rigorous, focused experience of that, it was really only just over a year ago I had this. I had what I would just describe as an absolutely life-changing. Experience in which I was able to integrate all of the lessons that I'd learned before and put them into practice in my life ahead.
Well, as we were talking in our presentations, the one that I just gave, I do believe that particularly with the bombardment of plasma onto the planet, that there will be more and more locations in which the ionic ratio shifts, in which people can go and meditate and have vision quest and fast and have experience. But I tried it both ways, and I did do for 7 years 5-day fast.
Yes.
And yet what occurred with me for ayahuasca in 4 hours never occurred in the same way with 7 years of fasting. I did gain by the fasting.
Yeah.
And no question.
Of course you did, yeah.
But what happened was a different lens and an accelerated, amplified process.
Yeah.
And
now, ayahuasca is undoubtedly a very powerful plant ally. And behind it, I am certain, lies a vast intelligence.
Yes.
I think of her as, in a way, the mother goddess of our planet, who is using ayahuasca to reach us at the level of consciousness, because we've become so shut down from the realm of spirit in this material world that you need to break through that barrier. And I totally agree with you, there are many ways to break through that barrier. But ayahuasca is peculiarly effective, and
absolutely.
That's because of the intelligence that lies behind it.
And I think it's unfortunate that even people who are spiritual, even people who are involved in metaphysics, tend to class visionary plants as an impure way, as a lesser way.
Such a mistake.
That the thing to do is to fast or to pray or to have the vision questing. What occurred for me through the sacred plants medicines, which I did in a sacred way, and I did have the experience with the mushrooms, with the peyote, with the San Pedro, and with the ayahuasca. Unquestionably, the ayahuasca was the was the huge one.
Yeah.
And but what occurred there, as the shaman expressed to me, I completed karma from 10 lifetimes in 4 hours. Yeah, exactly. It took me out of time far more effectively than the other ones, and it was a different lens, a different vibration, but far more powerful an experience.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that you're right. I mean, people have a kind of knee-jerk reaction to this, and they may even be people who are deeply involved in metaphysics, and they say, oh, somehow this is artificial, or you are just using a drug, and that's a quick shortcut.
Yes.
How can you get enlightenment that way? And it's almost a kind of snobbishness in a way.
Absolutely. You know,
that they believe that their method is superior
There's a self-righteousness
about it. And that is so wrong. I think the truth is, no method is superior. We have many ways to pass through the veil and to see the unseen reality that surrounds us. And what's right for one person may not be right for another person. And fortunately, nature has gifted us, the universe has gifted us with many doorways through the veil.
Yes,
And ayahuasca is one of those doorways.
Yes.
And I have to say, from my experience, an enormously effective one. But I would not put down somebody else who said, well, I don't want to take ayahuasca.
Yeah.
I want to get there totally by fasting. Absolutely, go for it. That's right and proper. But what that person shouldn't do is then turn around and say, and your method of getting there is inferior to mine, because that's not the case. And in fact, ayahuasca is extremely hard work, as we both know, both at the level of taking the brew, which involves quite severe physical and emotional and psychic consequences, but also at the level of what you do afterwards. That's really where the work begins. This is what I try to get across to people. This is not a magic pill.
Yes.
This is something that is going to open your eyes to what you need to do. And actually doing that's the work. That is the work, and that can take years to overcome a lifetime of bad habits, to overcome a lifetime of negativity, to gradually transform it into something pure and decent and good. That takes work, and it takes constant application, and you can never, never, never let up. So I regard, and I'm grateful to ayahuasca for setting me on the path, but that is a path of work that I have to do if I'm going to gain anything from it at all. I have to do the work.
Well, I find that I had the unique experience of being an expatriate, being a foreigner for 33 years and coming back, and had a bit of a culture shock coming back into my own country.
Mm-hmm.
But I really was intrigued by your talk, and I've always been drawn to the words of Socrates that says, citizenship is the world, and my nationality is goodwill.
Yeah, beautiful.
And I think that there is a time now for us to start to move together.
Yeah, to realize that we are one. Yeah. We are one.
Yes.
Humanity is one. We cannot be artificially divided by borders and boundaries and by artificial constructs like one religion or another, or by the color of our skin, or by our economic situation.
Yes.
We cannot be divided by this. We are one. And in the great totality, the oneness of humanity, we need to seek out like-minded folk who are like us and who we can construct something good with.
Yes.
And that cannot be defined by where we happened by accident to be born, or by the religion, but by chance we were born into and it was inculcated into us by our parents. We have to find our own way. That's why I make a strong emphasis on this whole issue of sovereignty over consciousness and adult responsibility.
Absolutely.
We must be sovereign over ourselves.
Absolutely.
And anything that works against that, we ourselves have to overcome it.
Absolutely.
And move forward.
You know, 2012, it represents so many different things to so many people. I really believe that 2012 is perhaps an expansion into greater awareness. Mm-hmm. I think that perhaps the coronal mass ejections, mm-hmm. the plasma, are a mechanism of this. Mm-hmm. But
I think you're very probably right about that.
And I think that it is the, if we were going to say ascension, mm-hmm. it is the planet that is perhaps ascending or transitioning,
taking
now,
us along with it,
and that it will take humanity another 10, 12, 15 generations in mass. I think that there are certainly enlightened people, and I consider you to be one, a great teacher. And but I think humanity in mass are going to wake up on the 22nd of December and say, what was the big deal? But I think the matrix will have changed and the possibility for us to move forward exists.
Well, I think what's going on is that we're on the road to change.
Yes.
And just as with the lessons we learned from ayahuasca, so also as a species,
yes,
there's work to be done.
Yes.
There's a lot of work to be done. It's not a magical thing, the 21st of December 2012. As you say, we do not all wake up on the 22nd transformed.
Exactly.
We have to transform ourselves, right, and that work will be long and hard, and many inimical forces are ranged against it, which are I believe specifically designed to suppress human consciousness and to deny us the chance of the great potential that the universe has gifted us with. And overcoming those inimical forces is a long and difficult work, and there will be ups and downs, and there will be losses as well as gains, and there will be suffering that has to be gone through. When you confront a powerful dark force, you have to expect that it is going to make it very difficult for you to overcome it. But that is, I love your phrase, the universe of duality, you know, the university of duality.
University of duality.
That is the lesson that we're here to learn. And it's an important lesson to learn. It's an important lesson because what is fundamental about the human being is the power of choice, that we have the power of choice. That's really what defines us, the choices we make through life. And in this university of duality, those are choices between good and evil, in very, very simple terms.
Yes.
And they are, both of those things are there to teach us.
Yes.
They're there to teach us. They're there to allow us to learn and grow and to develop, and gradually, perhaps through many lifetimes, to learn to make the right choices rather than the wrong ones.
I heard the phrase once that there's a doctor on earth called cause and effect, and he makes house calls.
That's a good one, yeah. And you know, I also resonate what you said about places on the planet and how those can affect our consciousness. And you know, perhaps there was at one time an ancient science of this. That,
yes, absolutely.
You know, if we put ourselves in the right place and perform the right ceremony, this also can have a huge effect on consciousness and help us, again, to grow and learn and develop.
And I think that while we think of the compestral societies, such as the Native Americans, the Aborigines, the tribesmen who recognized certain places as places of vision, I think they were also, before that, a highly advanced society that knew how to align to stellar grids to perceive
the ancient notion, as above, so below, is profound.
Yes.
And it carries an enormous meaning. And it once was a system that was deliberately and carefully used for the benefit of mankind.
Yeah.
And that's another thing we need to recover, but we have work ahead. It's fascinating, actually.
Well, you know, you speak about the need for us to have sovereignty, to recognize that there is something that tries to hold us back, and perhaps on a higher level, it is just the nature of our own purposed dream to have that duality aspect that forces us to learn how to master. But I think our past societies, I think that certain societies that had a very high spiritual level probably didn't learn how to handle violence, probably didn't learn how to stop when the aggressive thing.
Absolutely. Our society is like that today.
Yes,
our society today has not learned how to handle violence.
What would be the way that we handle that? How do we stop that without fighting head to head? You know, the statement that we'll never stop war by hating war. We'll stop it by loving peace.
Well, this is a complicated story.
Yeah.
You know, because at one level, there are certain dark forces manifesting through the human creature.
Yes.
Which use violence.
Yes.
In such a calculated, horrific, vicious way, that unfortunately, possibly the only way to stop them is with counter-violence. I'm sad to say that, but I take the case of Hitler, for example.
Absolutely.
Take the case of Hitler. That was a demonic force loose in the world in human form. And that demonic force absolutely had to be stopped. You couldn't wish that away.
Yeah.
You know, you had to, at a certain point, you had to stop that. And in a strange way, I regard myself as a pacifist, but in a strange way, that was a righteous war.
Yes,
that war had to be fought.
I'll tell you something fascinating that's occurred to me before. I think that that demonic force that we talk about with the Hitler gene surfaced a few centuries earlier as the Spanish acquisition.
Oh, my goodness.
And here's what I
such have, wickedness.
Here's what I've considered. I believe it was 1588, the defeat of the Spanish Armada.
Yes.
In the belly of those ships was the Spanish Inquisition, an enormous army, backed by several countries in Europe that were coming to take Queen Elizabeth out of power and install the Spanish Inquisition.
Yes.
But something happened. Something miraculous happened. Seemingly against all odds, those ships were destroyed by a force of nature.
Yeah, yeah.
I've often wondered, what caused that? Was that somehow a force that reached back in to alter a possible path that we have these probable realities that could go certain ways?
Yeah.
Is it possible that the defeat of the Spanish Armada was a greater part of human consciousness that diverted it away from that particular path?
Very interesting idea.
In order for us to move into the ascension.
Very interesting idea. I think it is. I think it is possible. Yeah, yeah. The Spanish Inquisition was just one of the most grotesque instruments of evil that has ever been inflicted on the human race. Its impact in many, many places. I spoke earlier today in my presentation about the Cathars. You know,
yes,
the Inquisition was involved in that.
Yeah.
It had to be stopped.
Yeah.
And in the case that you're talking about now, the universe seems to have come to our aid.
And you know, I wonder about these ideas of probable realities and sort of a Rubik's cube that we as a collective consciousness put together, and perhaps all these realities do exist, but the one we choose that leads to ascension is one of many. But perhaps in some sort of way, we have already ascended. Maybe there's some part that comes back and helps navigate certain aspects of incidents like the Spanish Armada.
Well,
perhaps even stopped Hitler from developing atomic weapons.
Yes, absolutely.
The odds were that
he was
a scientist, that he could have done that.
I know.
But something happened.
I know. Well, it's as though the universe selected certain people at that time to come forward and confront this demon.
Yes,
and face him down. He couldn't be wished away. He had to be stopped.
Exactly.
And the personalities were needed who would come out and stop him. And he was stopped. And so that can happen again.
And it gives you the idea that there is hope.
It does. That the ancient notion
against the odds.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The notion of the guardian angel. You know, that there are angelic as well as demonic forces.
Yes.
This, to me, is a very important idea.
Well, I think I shared with you the story that Ann and I had in Africa, where we literally should have been killed by a hippopotamus. Mm-hmm. And we were chased, and 75 witnesses watched it, and it appeared as if it hit bird wall and just stopped. Yeah. And not that we were any sort of highly advanced souls. I just think that each person has some sort of higher self that can prevent things from taking you out of the course you have planned for yourself.
Yeah, and, when that's a course you need to complete.
Exactly.
And it's not your time.
That you don't want to have to come back and start all over again. Yeah. And so there are forces that come to play to lead you toward.
Yes. Interesting. Very, very interesting. Yeah. And the notion of the guardian angel does fit in with that.
Absolutely.
I had what I realize now was a fundamental and transformatory experience when I was 16 years old. And in a way, some kind of mysterious intervention took place then too, which was that I was alone in my parents' house. They were away for the weekend. And I was barefoot and washing the dishes, and my hands were wet. And for some reason, I felt I wanted to check that an electric plug was plugged in properly. I reached down my hand without looking, and the back was off the plug. And I'm standing on a puddle of water with wet hands, and I touch a live wire. And I had the most gigantic electric shock. But instead of being stuck to that pole, I was thrown across the room. and I hit the opposite wall, and I slumped down on the floor. And at that moment, that's for me, was the beginning of a kind of initiation for me, because I left my body, and I was up around the light, as many people speak. I was out of my body, and I was looking down at my physical body there on the ground. And I was not afraid. I thought, how interesting. What's going to happen next? And then I was back into my body again, and I came out. It wasn't my time to step out of this physical life.
I wonder if we have certain potential exit points along the path.
Interesting.
In which there are crossroads.
Yeah.
And that the path that we really want to take, the path that we've really chosen for ourselves, in certain ways allows us to have an overview for a second and then come back in.
Yeah, so, very interesting. That's kind of what it was like. That's kind of what it was like. I decided not to take my exit.
Well, as much as I look at things and hear things, I'm not one to adhere to conspiracy theories, but I absolutely am opposed to putting our head in the sand and acting like
things
like the Illuminati don't exist. They absolutely do.
I'm completely with you. We must not put our heads in the sand, and we must not pretend that it is a kind of all woo-woo goodness.
Yes.
As you say, I've heard you say it, love is not enough without strength.
Excellent.
There has to be love and strength, and sometimes we must be strong.
And so many people in spirituality want to put on the rose-colored glasses and pretend that evil doesn't exist, and that doesn't work. That's not the answer. And I agree with you. There are certain situations where certain evils have to be stopped, and maybe that is one of the big quantum leaps that we need to learn how to make to stop things without becoming the very energy that we're stopping.
Well, that's absolutely right. Yeah. Without becoming evil ourselves.
Well, so many people that deal with negativity, unfortunately, such as not all, and that some people that are in law enforcement become corrupted by dealing with the very energy that they're trying to stop. And it's a harmonic oscillation to a certain degree. If you're around that, I do believe that quote-unquote psychic attack things can occur. I believe that we do have a magnetic field around ourselves, and we have to be very careful about what energies that get in there. Okay. And it is so easy to try to stop negativity in such a way that we become the very thing we're trying to stop.
Exactly. That's the challenge, actually.
Yeah.
That's the challenge, to deal in this university of duality.
Yes.
To deal with the negative pole
and
not become negative ourselves.
Yes. That's a good way to phrase it. Yeah. Graham, thank you very much.
It's
absolutely been an honor.
Tremendous to talk to you.
You are a tremendous person,
a great inspiration.
Thank you. And the wonderful thing as well is that so many people that become known for their expertise, for their writing, for their mastery, get caught up in the trap of ego. And you're sharing your open heart, and it is absolutely the mark of a master, and I honor you. I really acknowledge you for that.
Thank you. Thank you, and thanks for having me here. It's been a great experience.
It's been an absolute pleasure.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Graham.